Here we go.
Hi, I'm Nick D, and I'm here to address a problem that's plaguing millions of programmers all across the globe. Of course, I'm talking about RSA. In the arms of the angels, fly away from... And for only a few ETH per day, you can help eradicate RSA from the world. Thanks for coming to my TED Talk. Back to you, Ben.
You are now about to witness the strength of street knowledge.
Thanks for that important message, Nick. All right.
What?
Is that why your assistant works? Okay, so I'd just like to start off by saying, fuck RSA. Fuck the company RSA. Fuck the conference. And fuck these things. Actually, wait, does anyone in the audience have a secure ID on them? Oh, yeah, cool. Apparently more physically secure than cryptographically secure. All right. So, disclosure, I've never met Ron Rivest, but I'm convinced he's a lizard person. Adi Shamir, he's been canceled. And Leonard Adelman, he's a biologist now. So to get into why I have these feelings about RSA, I'm going to have to like lay some math on you. And it might get a little bit hard to follow, but let's get going. So RSA was invented in 1977, which is the same year Elvis died. Now, if you take Rivest, Shamir, Adelman, and Elvis using the Chaldean numerology system, you get these numbers. And when you add them, you have 78. Now, adding the proper RSA key size in 2019, and subtracting the number of days Barack Obama was president, we wind up with 1254. But divide that by two, and add the age that Buzz Aldrin was when he faked the moon landing, you get 666. That's right. Mathematical proof that RSA is the devil's work. But if pure logic won't convince you, perhaps we could take a look at how RSA actually works. All right, so RSA is a public key crypto system where a user, Alice, can publish a key on the internet so that anyone can send her a secret message that she can decrypt. And the way that she's going to do this is she's going to generate two primes, P and Q, and then two other numbers, E and D, which are the encryption and decryption exponents. And so what she'll do is she'll publish N and E on the internet, and Bob can use that to send her a message. So he's gonna take his message M, raise it to the ETH power, and reduce that modulo N. To decrypt it, Alice is just going to raise the ciphertext to the DTH power mod N and get M back. And this is because E and D are like modular inverses of each other. So one undoes what the other one does. But you can also do something called a digital signature with RSA. And that's sort of just the reverse of the encryption procedure. So Alice wants to take a piece of data and prove that she actually like put that data somewhere. And what she'll do is she'll take her message M and raise it to the DTH power. And that's the signature. And she'll send the data and the signature to Bob, who can then check that the signature raised to the ETH power is M again. Now, in the real world, you would like hash the message and also pad it. We'll talk more about padding later, but this is kind of like the core math of RSA. Simple enough. But we're going to see that at every step of this process, things can go catastrophically wrong. Okay. Does this mic work? Cool. So let's talk about parameter selection, all the things that Alice can do to totally mess things up before she even encrypts a message. So this is sort of like the key RSA equation, right? M to the E to the D is M back again when you reduce it mod PQ. So in this process, Alice is going to need to pick two primes. And there are a lot of things that can go wrong here. So if she ever reuses a prime, she's done. An attacker can use the GCD algorithm. If P and Q share half of their upper bits, then an attacker can factor the modulus. If P or Q have too many contiguous zeros, you can factor the modulus. And then if like P minus one and Q minus one has small prime factors, you can also factor N. The point is that really weird, subtle math will totally screw you over in this situation. And Alice is just like a software engineer. She doesn't know number theory, and she shouldn't have to. Because, like, yeah, there's just all these subtle pitfalls here. You might be wondering, does this ever actually burn people in real life? Well, a couple of years ago, there was this thing called ROCA, which was a vulnerability in almost all smart cards produced over the last decade that allowed an attacker to, like, totally compromise the RSA key. And this was due to some, like, weird algebraic properties that they had, like, accidentally baked into the keys. But to, like, make this really concrete, what that looks like is if the person sitting next to me has a smart card that authorizes them to see data that I shouldn't see, and they leave for lunch and leave that card on the desk, I can clone their smart card. This is, like, a really devastating attack that could lead to the compromise of tons of private information. Okay, so that's just the primes. Let's look at the private exponent D. So people want to pick a small d because it speeds up decryption. Unfortunately, if you do this, you're totally screwed. If you pick d less than the quarter root of the RSA modulus, then anyone can recover the whole key. Now, you can kind of work around this by doing some even more crazy math called the Chinese remainder theorem, but that's also a bad idea because really subtle implementation faults in that algorithm lead to a total system compromise. All right, so finally, the last parameter that she has to pick, E, the public exponent. This one, cryptographer, so the other three, Alice had to pick in private, which is really bad because she can do all this like crazy stuff and no one would know. But with E, cryptographers can actually recommend parameters for her to use. So people recommend you use something called a Fermat prime. And the recommended one to use is 65,537 for like math reasons. E is the worst choice here, but developers always like to pick E. And that can lead to all sorts of weird stuff that isn't like a total system compromise, but like related messages could be decrypted. So if Bob was encrypting like a counter or some like algebraic relationship between messages, then an attacker could like recover that. If Alice accidentally leaks part of her key, then an attacker can recover the key if the exponent's small. And maybe even forge signatures if a couple other things go incorrectly. Say that once more.
People have used E equal one.
Oh, yeah, no, we'll get there. yeah. All right. So, yeah, you might be. So, yeah, the cryptographers in the crowd might kind of call me out on this and be like, well, E equals three is only bad if you don't pad your RSA message, and everyone should pad your RSA message. But the thing is, developers love to roll their own RSA. I don't know what it is about this crypto system, but people just love writing their own code to do it, and they always mess up. They don't use padding. They use all of the worst parameters. It's a disaster. And even when they do use real libraries that are like vetted, they do inexplicably weird things, like you pointed out, and set E equal to 1. The thing about E equals 1 is it's actually not encrypting anything. It's raising the message to the first power. the state of affairs is pretty bad. But I'd like to say that this isn't totally developers' fault. You see, the thing is that they shouldn't need to understand algebraic number theory to encrypt messages. That's a cryptographer's job, not a developer's job. And cryptographers need to focus on crypto systems that abstract away those algebraic number theoretic details from the developers. Okay, so that's parameter selection. Now, as I mentioned earlier, RSA needs something called padding. Why does RSA need padding? So let's say Bob is president of some country, and he has a nuclear launch site that he sends a message, don't fire, to every day. just like, hey, checking in, don't do anything. And Eve is the president of a rival country and is very interested in what Bob says to his nuclear launch site. And the thing is that RSA is a deterministic encryption scheme, so don't fire is going to encrypt to the same thing every single time. And so Eve can kind of deduce, like, hey, I see this message that gets sent every day. Nothing happens. It's probably like a no-op. So she takes that, kind of like tucks it away for later. And then her and Bob get into some argument, and that escalates. And Bob is like, I think I need to launch a missile at Eve.
Go Nukes.
Yeah, exactly. The nuclear option. And so then Bob sends a different message one day. It's fire. Now, Eve can't actually decrypt this message because, she hasn't broken RSA, but she can kind of deduce, because of the fact that her and Bob are in an argument and she knows what he sent every day before that, that this might be fire. So what she does is she just swaps those two messages out and sends a don't fire. So this is called semantic security in cryptography. It's like the fancy word for this, and RSA doesn't have it, which is why you need to add randomized padding at the beginning of every message that you send. You also need to pad signatures for other reasons, and we're going to look at that now. So this is the PKCS number 1 version 1.5 padding for RSA signatures. And as you can see, the hash needs to be all the way on the right in this signature. But sometimes people who implement this forget to check that, and there might be garbage at the end. And it turns out that if that happens, and E equals 3, then you can forge signatures using RSA. And you might be like, this is such a specific combination of things that have gone wrong. Like, does this actually happen in the real world? And the answer is yes. In 2006, Chrome, OpenSSL, and Firefox were all found to be vulnerable to this attack. So let's look at now the padding for normal encrypted messages. This is also the PKCS number 1 version 1.5 padding. And here we see it's like a similar structure, but there are some random bytes in the middle instead of all those Fs. But if you're not careful, something called a padding oracle attack could happen. So what's a padding oracle attack? Let's say Alice is trying to connect to some server, Bob, and she sends her pre-master secret to the server, and it's padded. And Bob is like, cool, got that, and it works. But Eve was looking at that. So what she's going to do is she's going to take that padded message and multiply it with some random junk that she encrypted. And she's going to send that to Bob. And with a really high probability, that's just going to be like more garbage, right? It's not going to be a valid padding. It's just, random bytes. But what if she just kept trying until she finally got a message that was okay? This won't be Alice's ciphertext, but it will prove that the random junk that Eve multiplied with a padded message produced another properly padded message. And Eve can use this information to sort of deduce certain properties of Alice's original message. And actually, if she repeats this this process strategically over and over again over the course of like a million messages, she'll eventually recover the plain text. So this is really bad, and this was discovered back in 98, and it totally wrecked SSL. And people tried to patch it by saying, okay, we shouldn't throw a padding error when this happens, we should do some other stuff. But then, I think it was 2017, the robot attack happened, which was just a modified version of this. They found out that really all you need is that yes, no, whether or not this is padded correctly, and that there are other ways you can find it. And this team actually was able to sign arbitrary messages with Facebook and PayPal's private key. So, 2017. That's bone-chilling. And this continued to happen over and over and over again. People found different ways to get that one bit of information, whether it was through a side channel like timing attack or a more convoluted like understanding of like how TLS works. You could like downgrade sessions to older versions of SSL. It's an attack that won't go away and has been like prevalent, especially recently. Like all these attacks here happened after 2015. So it appears that we kind of sort of can't circumvent this attack. People have tried to come up with other padding schemes, and those also, like, even though they've been proven to be secure, often in practice fail to prevent padding oracles. So this is a major problem for RSA. It's an added complexity that no other, that elliptic curve public key encryption schemes don't have, which is that, like, you just don't need to implement padding schemes for them. Okay, so what should you use instead? I kind of already said it. You should use elliptic curves. They're freaky, weird math that people don't really understand, but that's okay because we got good enough at doing them that you, as like a user, just need to use this API that's very friendly and only requires you to generate some random bytes. Elliptic curves are important because, unlike RSA, where users make all the security critical parameter choices, here, professional cryptographers choose the curve, they choose all of the related parameters, and all you have to do, like I said, is just generate some random bytes. Which curve should you use? You should use a curve 25519. The encryption version of this is called X25519, and the signature version is ED25519. A good library to check out is Libsodium. They have a lot of like really clear use cases and run you through how to actually do this stuff in like a proper and secure way. So I'd really encourage you checking that out if you haven't already. Okay, so I'm gonna leave you with some final thoughts. RSA was invented back in the 70s, which people sort of consider to be the dark ages of cryptography. We didn't really know what we were doing back then. People hadn't like really formulated good security definitions. But it was okay to use it then because it was the best that we had. In the 90s, we got better at using elliptic curves. And then in 2005, Sweep B was standardized, which, I mean, say what you will about the NSA and all that stuff, but it kind of showed that like elliptic curves had become mature enough to be used for real stuff. At that point, everyone should have switched, but could be forgiven for not. But then in 2014, Libsodium had its first stable release. And after that, there's just no excuse to be using RSA anymore. To put this into perspective, the last time it was okay for you to use RSA was around the time that you were texting people on your Razor about the cool DVD you got at Blockbuster. Like, it's really ancient at this point. And you know, every time I talk to software engineers about this, they're like, look, I get it. Like, RSA is hard, developers are dumb, it's really risky, but like, I can do it, right? My implementation's okay. And the answer is definitely no. It's always broken. And the thing is that, like, I don't know what it is about software engineers and RSA, but they just have way more confidence than they should, and more so than any other area of cryptography. Like, I've never come across someone who's like, yeah, I just, like, implemented my own version of AES or, like, SHA-3. That would be kind of ridiculous, but they always do it with RSA. And I think this is maybe because we teach people RSA in an extremely simplified way. Like, people learn about it in their first security class or their first cryptography class, and like, oh, I can do modular exponentiation, whip up a Python script, and be like encrypting messages in like 10 minutes. And that's just wrong. And cryptographers need to educate people a lot better about that. Ooh. Okay. I'd also like to make a case that there's like a herd immunity argument here that we need to keep in mind. Like, there are people who have used RSA successfully, and I think that they're the problem. Because everyone can look at them and say, it's like, well, you can do it. You can use RSA securely. But the problem is then everyone starts to think that, and then it just, like, it never goes away. We just need to agree that RSA is not acceptable, and the people that can use it okay need to just, like, take one for the team and never use it. Okay, and this shouldn't be a hard switch to make because elliptic curves are so much easier to use than RSA. We have really good libraries for implementing them, and like no one wants to deal with the headache of making sure that they like implemented this crazy padding signature or padding scheme correctly. It's just like a waste of time at this point. And I'd like to kind of like leave you with this cool quote I found from the Tink documentation, which is a misuse-resistant cryptography library developed at Google, and it says, using crypto in your application shouldn't have to feel like juggling chainsaws in the dark. And that's right. And as cryptographers and security engineers, we need to take that really seriously. We need to like build APIs that are misuse resistant, and we need to keep in mind that users shouldn't be expected to understand really nuts math and navigate that total minefield of parameter choices. So that's what you should do if you're a security professional. Otherwise, you should just keep in mind that you should never use RSA. It should have died like 20 years ago. Just fuck it. We're done. Thanks. Yeah, does anyone have any questions?
Great.
All right, cool. I said, use lib sodium or curve 25519. Those are safe. Does anyone want to take another crack at that key, or did it disappear? cool. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Ben. That was terrific. So we have a little bit of time here for everyone to find their way to the bar. To tip your bartender. We'll be back at 4:30 for Sliver. Thank you.